Welcome viewers to another exciting episode of the Big Leap from Mirai Asset. It's an honor and privilege and quite excited to have a very young and a very dynamic mutual fund distribution professional from Calcutta. We have with us today Abhinav Khetri. Abhinav is a very known person in the distribution circle within mutual funds across India. He needs no introduction. He's a Doon School and a St. Xavier's alumnus. He has been working as an FA from 2003. He started Viana in 2008 and since then is one of the most dynamic, multi-award-winning mutual fund distribution setups across India. He's very well known for his views and for his inroads with institutional and individual clients in Calcutta and across the world. So Abhinav, welcome to the Big Leap. Thank you so much for being a part of this. One of the things which I really appreciate at Viana is what I would always look forward is the interesting calendar which Viana makes every year, where you talk about your passion also. So I would like you to touch upon that also during the course of our discussion. So why don't you tell our viewers, how did you start Viana and how did your journey begin?
Thank you so much, Mayuk. Thank you for the very, very nice introduction. Very generous of you. I think the foundation or the seed behind any business idea comes from an inherent need for that. And sure. I felt that when I was in college in 2004, 2005, you know, the capital market was just restarting, bouncing back after the 2000 crisis which happened. And interest rates had come to a real low in 2004, if you remember. FD rates had reached 6.5%. Indians were not used to such low fixed income returns. Yes. And I think that is where the need for financial advisory or capital market related services, I think, started off again in India. And this was a very nascent stage. I still remember seeing Sensex at 5,000-6,000 in that time period. And our family had sold some properties. There was surplus cash which needed to be deployed. And the go-to was, of course, putting it back into the business or putting in fixed income securities. But the yield was so low in fixed income securities that we started evaluating other options. My family had never invested in equity, so there was a need to have some kind of a person who could, guide them, handhold them. So I said, why don't I do it myself? That's how the initial idea came into my mind. And it was also more to do with financial independence. I wanted to do something of my own. I didn't want to be asking my parents for pocket money and things like that. So I was all of 19 or 20 when I got my ARN. And that's how I started off initially. And then after my graduation, I worked for a year with this company called Optimix, which was an Australian multi-manager. It had just started off in India that time as yes. part of the distribution team in Calcutta. And that really allowed me to meet a lot more IFAs, to meet a lot of bankers and see how business is actually supposed to be done, how business is actually supposed to be done. And that kind of allowed me to kind of opened my mind, because earlier I was running a very small setup and most of the clients were in-house. It kind of taught me how to actually face clients, how to meet them, how to acquire new relationships, how to advise them, get to know. I think it was the best platform to learn, because if you have to sell multiple products of multiple yes. fund houses, then Optimix was the best place to learn, because they were actually doing research on funds and not on stocks. So it was a great, great learning ground for me. And after about a year there, then I started off on my own. And it's been a fantastic journey since then.
Yeah. All your awards and others do talk about that. But since 2008 till now, how has been the journey? How did you get your initial clients? Then changes in the business, markets going up and down. How was the journey since then?
I used to live in a very large housing society where there were about 400 flats. So I did a lot of, promotional campaigns, or you can say interesting events. So I used to organize quizzes, for example, during Durga Puja and things like that. So that allowed us to showcase, end of the day, we are in the knowledge business. So how do you showcase knowledge? How do you showcase awareness? So I used to organize quizzes. I used to be the quiz master. And through that, it kind of allowed me to engage with people of how, what are the different avenues available to do investments. So I would always add a round on financial investments and capital markets. So that would kind of pique the interest of my neighbors and my people in the audience. And we should do a lot of visits to factories, visits to corporates, just to sit, have a meal with them, talk to them, what they're planning and things like that. So it was a lot of one-to-one interaction initially. I used a lot of my alumni network. I used a lot of my parents' contacts. I used a lot of my own contacts, which I built through college. And I think it was just a very carpet-bombing exercise. And you kind of hoped that people 20, 30 years older than me would take me seriously. So the initial challenge was my age, because I was so young. Nobody takes you seriously when you're 22, 23. And I think I must say that the people who trusted me since then are still with me, even after so many years. And they've given a chance to a young boy to handle them with their money management. And I think one of the other reasons is that there are not too many people who are actually doing this business. If you, at a population level, I mean, the number of financial advisors in our country is so few that it's a huge market. You know, it's very virgin. You have to just go out there and do a good job and people will respond. It's not any rocket science, according to me.
Yeah, I think your last point is very powerful when you think about the number of investable universe and the number of people who are there to manage your investments. So I know about your activities, which you do every year, and I mentioned about that in the introduction. So I really want you to touch upon that subject, that one is your passion and how do you do that in your client interactions during the year?
See, it's very simple. When you're sitting for a conversation with an investor, the discussion about the financial side of things is, I think, just 20% of the discussion. 80% is the other stuff. And I think you have to be a good conversationalist. You have to have good content. You should be able to bring up interesting topics. You should know a bit about the client's background. What does he like to read? What does he like to do? What are his passions? So I feel that if you can bring up interesting things in a conversation, they can always trust you more. They can always like you more and eventually want to do business with you. So, for example, the event I think you're referring to, which we did last year, was this event called Defenders of India, where I saw an opportunity where there's a huge gap between our defense capabilities, our geostrategic capabilities, and what the civilians know, what we as individuals know about our own forces, our own capabilities as a nation. So my job was to simply marry this information gap, converge the information gap, bring forward perspectives to Indians about how strong we are as a nation. And I want to add a financial angle to it, 22% of the tax that you and me pay goes towards defense. So why don't we know more, and why are we not proud about what we are as a nation? So the idea actually came to me because I have a lot of friends and clients in the defense services, and I see the kind of hard work that they do and the difficult life conditions that they have. And I think as civilians, we don't appreciate them enough. Yes, there are movies made for them. There are other governmental, honors which are done. But as civilians, what are we doing? So it is also a way to give back, to honor and to kind of appreciate the services that our defense forces do for us. And I made it in the format of a calendar.
Yes.
We did a calendar launch where we brought forward not just the three main defense arms, which is the Army, Navy and the Air Force, but also our 9 paramilitary forces and how they are serving the nation, how they're serving us on a daily basis. We do see a bit of the Army here and there. We see the CISF at the airports. But apart from that, we only see the local police. But there is such a large mechanism in play which is working behind the scenes to serve the country. So I felt that this was something which should be discussed, something which should be brought forward. So we did this event called Defenders of India, where we had invited Major Maruf Raza, a former army man, a television commentator, defense analyst, to give a talk about what India's defense is all about. So I had about 350 people who came for that event, and it went really well. I had about 35 serving and retired officers also from the Army, Navy and the Air Force who shared their life experiences. I had Mr. Karan Datta. So Karan and me go back a long way, and I had requested him to be like a co-host to help me with the event in terms of doing a Q&A session and doing an audience session. And he also brought forward his geopolitical perspectives, and I think he has now. So I've done various other talks, follow-up events after that, all online. And Karan is now becoming a very, very popular speaker. I'm so happy for him. And it is, I think, very important for us, because the stock market is completely linked to the security of the country. If the country is not safe, if the country is in turmoil, if there is external aggression, the markets will never do well. So understanding geopolitics, understanding defense is very important. And this has been showcased since June onwards, ever since China became aggressive with us. And knowing this, understanding this is becoming very, very critical for every investor. That was my only reason for doing it.
So it's a different way to come to the stock markets when you look at national stuff being connected to the capital markets. So Abhinav, my question to you would be, now we have seen investors of all foray. You have been managing institutional investors, you have been managing individuals and HNIs. What do you think are the key ingredients for a successful investor? How does one actually make money?
So my companies, before the event we did last year, Defenders of India, we did an event prior to that, which was called Managing Behavior, Not Just Money. That became my company slogan now. That's written everywhere, wherever my company's name is written, we always say that. I think human behavior management or being able to control oneself in situations is the key to being good at anything, not just being a good investor. Even if you're driving your car, if you are too rash, if you take impulsive decisions, if you're not careful enough, you can go wrong on the road also. Same thing with investing, same thing with anything in life. You need to have control over yourself, over your mind, and a good investor, be it institutional or retail or whoever he or she may be, the main thing is to be able to segregate emotional decision making when it comes to financial investments. Financial investments have to be done rationally, have to be done with a goal in mind, have to be done with proper hand-holding from a distributor or an advisor. I feel that investors who are not good investors are ones who get very emotional, who get very irrational, follow every media news or advice from friends, because the media has a habit to write what is negative. Okay, that's what gives you more eyeballs. If you keep reading the papers and keep investing, you will miss the bus by a long margin. For example, and I think 2020 has shown us that. 2020 is the best evidence we have for behavior management. Whoever could hold their nerves have done very well. Whoever couldn't hold their nerves are sitting outside and are actually grumbling now, why is the market going up? So I have no other answer.
Sure. No, I think it's a very pertinent point. So my last question, Abhinav, is, given the times, as you talked about 2020, when you look at 2020 and we are at the end of it, what would be your view ahead for the mutual fund distribution as a profession, and what would be your advice be to other fellow MFD partners?
It's a very interesting question, especially since I'm part of the industry. So I'm a person who's very, very vocal on several issues. But I do feel that our regulator is not understanding the crux of the problems or the challenges that not only us, but even the investor faces. Yes, the regulator is doing a lot of things for the benefit of the investor. And it has always been seen that if the end consumer benefits, the whole distribution mechanism or the manufacturer, everyone benefits in that industry. That is a known fact. However, our business is a bit different. Our business is not just about a few basis points here or there. The key thing that we need to realize now is that what is the way forward? Because I have seen an era which was 2007, 2008, where the revenues were fantastic, but volumes were small. Today, volumes are very, very large, but margins have really shrunk. So it's all a game of how do you adapt to the new normal? How do you adapt to disruption when it comes to technology? How do you adapt to the new savvy investors who are, say, below 35, who don't want to talk to a human being? They want to talk to computers, they want to talk to websites, they want to talk to algos. And I think the challenge that the distribution fraternity will not face so much from, will face from direct plans, of course, but I think the direct investing in stocks is, I think, a bigger challenge that the industry is going to face. Especially since it's becoming very easy, very cheap, brokerage rates have really fallen, and enormous access to information, not necessarily knowledge, but enormous access to information. Absolutely. So I feel the challenges are not within the industry, I think are more external. And the only savior for us are low interest rates. as long as we keep having low interest rates, there will be demand for capital market related products. There will be demand for mutual funds, equity related mutual funds. And I feel that it's a tough business for a newcomer, especially because to build a audience today than when I started off 12 years ago is going to be much tougher, primarily because A, the options are too many in terms of competition, and two, technology and online platforms which are available. And thirdly is that you don't get any upfront revenue. It's a completely deferred gratification business now. So you have to work very, very hard in the initial few years to build up a trail book. So my entire point is that why would someone do that? You know, you would rather get into a job, you'd rather get into some kind of a other business which will give you this kind of you know, upfront revenue. The only reason I see for newcomers to come in will be with, if they have funding, if they have coming in for the valuation game, who are coming in to build a large AUM over a period of time, exit on a certain valuation. For the existing players, the challenge will be in terms of you know, staying relevant when it comes to technology, and you know, not falling foul with the new regulations that are coming up in the industry. And to keep on, you know, coming up with new innovative ideas, because we cannot keep selling the same old funds, the same old strategies. You have to be, you know, ready for what's happening in terms of, like, for example, international funds as a category is something which I have been very vocal about for a long, long time. And because India is just 2% of the global markets, so why not have more money invested in larger companies or larger markets? So that's been one of the ideas I've been talking about for a long time, and that's really played out well. We need to look beyond the regular large cap, mid cap stuff. We need to look beyond all that. We need to understand exactly what the client needs and marry risk with his appetite. That's the bottom line in any form of advisory.
Lovely, Abhinav. I think a couple of very strong points, I think, which you mentioned about. I think learnings for us also in terms of seeing that even products will get more technical and probably more, because when needs become much more refined, then products tend to become more complicated, because then they are for a specific niche sort of audience. So thank you, Abhinav, so much for being generous with your time and your views. Really appreciate. Thank you for your association with Mirae Asset. And we wish you and Vyana all the best for the future. And thank you again for being a part of Big Leap. And so viewers, thank you so much. And we look forward to bring more such stories again in the future. Thank you and take care.
Thank you, Mayuk.
Thank you. Have a pleasure.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.